Blog Talk Radio.
Yo, 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 what's up, world? It's Badass Thuggin' like I usually do. And you better turn it up, bust some speakers out, cause we off the motherfucking cuff. You dig how we do it? Dog Pound Gangsters 2000 and beyond. Blech. Yo, yo, check this out. This is your girl, Cola Coke, and I'm chilling with my boys right here on Off the Cuff Radio. We off the cuff right now. You dig?
What's up? It's your boy Lil Yap from LV, ragging up from the river, cooling with my homies and my family at Off the Cuff Radio. Y'all be sure to tune in on Fridays and get the latest scoop and find out what's happening. You hear me?
And this Queen Queasy, your girl's favorite bartender.
And we're from
Sex on the Rocks podcast.
All right, you're now tuning in to Off the Cuff Radio.
Yeah, because they keep representing that world hip hop. Yo, much love.
All right. Y'all, this is Princess Daisy giving a shout out to King Eric and Off the Cuff Radio. Keep doing your thing, puppy.
Hey y'all, this is Stacey Lachey giving a shout out to King Eric and Off the Cuff Radio.
What's shaking, y'all? This is the Grand, one half of Lost Cause and one third of that Drive Time thing. Sending my love to the homies over at Off the Cuff Radio. Tune in every Friday night for some real deal hip hop conversation. These dudes are the connoisseurs of this thing. You already know what it is. BX Stand Up, Hud City, we're shaking. Peace.
Yo, this is Joe Fresh to Dine, and y'all tuned in to the most raw, uncut show on radio. The Guillotine Team, Off the Cuff, and yo, Eric Sandman, Off the Cuff Clown.
You know what gang violence is, mostly, and the people don't want you to hear this? Somebody shoots your family member. So, of course, you retaliate. You know what I mean? Same thing the U.S. does, except nobody even shot their family members. You know, somebody bomb a school and all these people get killed, so the United States feel like, ooh, that's messed up. We got to go show them who's the real killer.
This country was built on gangs. You know, I think this country still is run on gangs. Republicans, Democrats, the police department, the FBI, the CIA, those are gangs. You know what I mean? The correctional officers. I had a correctional officer tell me straight up, we the biggest gang in the United States. Straight up.
Introduce a drug called crack to us ghetto teens. Got a lot of raw niggas now. Play of what it be like. When will niggas see they got us leading with three strikes? Can't seem to focus, hopeless. With violent thoughts, I'm hopeless. Got the devil petrified. Hot for my hope to focus. And so I learn to earn my currency in overtime. Affiliated, clearly click a military mind. May God forgive us so we dwell inside of paradise. Thugged out and drug dealers from the womb to the block. My live mind got me surviving five rounds. My 45 got me fortified with live rounds. When shit kick, we block hit. One block stick, all hell. I don't bear wrath, that's apocalypse. Forever ghetto necessary, picture food stamps. Outlaw thug niggas never left the food
stamps. We got the real live shit from front to back. To my niggas in the world, to block the back.
DJ,
from my soldiers to death, from my soldiers to death. Where the fuck my soldiers at? From my soldiers to death. We got the real live shit from front to back. To my niggas in the world, to block the back. Where my soldiers to death.
Now I was born as a rebel, making trouble for the devil. Take this gangbang shit to a whole nother level. Can you feel me now? Armies in every city, definition of power. Players, are you with me? See the war is the prophecy. Survival is the strategy. Rest in peace to my comrades, that's the seat. Organize the streets of time. Yeah, any devil petrified of a nigga in his right mind. They tell us that we hopeless and hellbound. It's for the brothers and penitentiary jail bam. I got you in my heart till the day I die. Think of the damage we could do if we wasn't high. Can you picture me low? It's a thug rap. Political contracts and bloodbaths. From a Tupac Shakur up in the rockets, though they got you. I never let them stop me. The struggle continues.
Now, if we do want to live a thug life and a gangster life and all of that, okay. So stop being cowards and let's have a revolution. But we don't want to do that. Dudes just want to live a character. They want to be cartoons. But if they really wanted to do something, it was that tough. All right, let's start our own country. Let's start a revolution. Let's get out of here. Let's do something.
Well, I said, come front to back. Put my niggas in the world to rock and rock. Where my soldiers are at? Where my soldiers are at? Where the fuck my soldiers at? Where my soldiers are at? We got the real life.
Mr. Shakur, can you please explain the meaning behind your violent lyrics?
Explain the meaning? Fuck these niggas talking about.
Please, please! I can't freeze you, Mr. Black, son of a bitch!
My attitude is shit. My message to the censorship committee. Who's the biggest gang of niggas in the city?
The critics or the cops?
The courts or the crooks? Don't look so confused. Take a closer look.
Niggas get their neck broke daily, trying to stay jail free.
What the fuck does Quail know? A young black male? Please tell me. Message to the censorship committee. Who's the biggest gang of niggas in the city?
I pack a 9mm cause I gotta live in hotter than the 4th of July. If I gotta die, I gotta.
Mama told me don't let him save me. Nigga, don't let him make you crazy. Game is what she gave me.
Gotta watch your back strap.
Real niggas rap back.
If you get your ass packed, bring the gas back. That's not the way we made it.
That's just the way it is. Slang and rock, better niggas kid.
I came up, my message to the censorship committee. Who's the biggest gang of niggas in the city? Cops pull me over, check my paper, but I'm leaves, girl.
You couldn't get me, figure fuck with a nigga's people.
They got me trapped, cat with the motherfucking hammer back.
Cops on my back, just cause I'm black, snap.
Now I'm guilty, message to the censorship committee. Who's the biggest gang of niggas in the city?
All you punk police will never fall beats on the streets till the niggas get a piece. Fuck them. They kill you to control you.
Pay
top dollar for your soul.
Real niggas don't fold, straight soldier.
Can't find peace on the streets till the niggas get a piece. Fuck police. Hear them screaming, fuck them. Can't find peace on the streets till the niggas get a piece. Fuck police.
I hear them
screaming, fuck them. Can't find peace on the streets till the niggas get a piece. Fuck police.
I hear ya.
Fuck them. Can't find peace on the streets till the niggas get a piece. Fuck police.
I hear ya.
Fuck them. Can't find peace on the streets till the niggas get a piece.
What is you saying? Dude, it's the new millennium. Nigga, you still believing in a spook, a mystery, a ghost coming out the damn sky? Fam, that's not what it do. I'm gonna call my boy in here. Hey, Khan, young Khan. Man, would you teach this dude something, man? Damn.
Who is God? The people wanna know. He ain't a spook, damn, sure he ain't a ghost. But he is a man who ain't hard to see. Exodus chapter 15, verse 3. Makes everything plain when it says that the Lord is a man of war and the Lord is his name. Somebody ran game and told you a lie about a mystery God floating up in the sky. But
Since you and I, we both created in his image. And since you can't argue with it, let me finish. Cause he can see, he can hear, he can talk. Got hands, got feet, and he can walk. But we all thought, and we were taught, that he's a spirit. The truth shall set you free, you know it when you hear it. Now how can he be everywhere at the same time, and be a mystery, something that you can't find? It just don't make sense, son. Mathematically, we could never take three and put it into one. I know for some that is truly hard, but the answer is simple to the question of who is God.
So you saying God is a man, right? I mean, but how a man gonna be God? I mean, he be knowing everything. Like, I mean, when was he born? What'd he be on?
The Bible calls him the Son of Man, because in truth, that's exactly what he is, if you understand. If you've seen the Son, then you've seen the Father. But right here is where it gets a little bit hard. Cause if the Son is white, and God is white, and God is good, are we the opposite up in the hood? You say what color don't matter. If it didn't, why did Michelangelo, when he painted him, make him a crack? The slave master got his hands full, cause the book said that he had hair like lamb's wool, and feet like brass, burnt in an oven, not Michelangelo's cuss. He sure what? Don't be a hater, cause these are the facts, man. Jesus was and is a black man. I know for some that is truly hard, but the answer is simple to the question of who is God.
Damn, that's deep, man. I kind of feel what you're saying.
You wanna know who is God?
But I mean, I'm just saying. You know, I believe in, you know, God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Ghost, man. What you mean, what color is it? Hey, he white. What? Don't you see the picture when you go to church? The long hair, the blue eyes, the dude with the little white baby and everything, man. Come on, man.
Why does the scripture say God will come, huh? Where has he been? Where is he from? If every eye shall see him as he is, then he has to look something like you and me. You disagree? Let me state my case. Cause he did speak to Moses face to face. He came in sinful flesh to condemn sin in the flesh, from the east to the west, yes. Like a thief in the night, no alibi. Chapter 4, 4 through 6, book of Malachi. He raised Elijah, they did they thing. Read Deuteronomy 18, 18. In 1930, he made himself known to represent the black man and put him back on his throne. I know for some that it has to be hard to accept God in Master Farah. Muhammad, he's the one we've been waiting on, with the power to destroy our enemies and take Satan on. Now you know who God is, make your mind up and let Louis Farrakhan serve as a reminder.
Man, you on some other stuff, man. So what I can't argue what you're saying. You believe what you believe, I'm gonna believe what I believe, okay? I'm just saying though. Now, hey man, let me get your number or something, man. And I'll holler at you again.
You done blew my high.
And we are now live at a special Sunday night edition of Off the Cuff Radio, episode 283. What's the deal, y'all? This your boy King Eric the Great, a.k.a. Rick Capo, coming at y'all with another special show on this special Sunday night. I have my host in the building, T-Max, with the facts.
The Bible teaches that he met Abraham in the plains of Mamre. Three men came to Abraham, and one of them, the Bible says, was the Lord. But he's not
Game
a man.
Drop right there.
Sarah came out of the tent and said, Lord, if I have found favor, pass not away.
That's type
and
of show right
comes
there.
Out and says,
yeah,
Lord,
man.
If you're hungry,
yeah, man.
I will feed you. But how can you feed a spirit?
You be quiet for a minute.
He
let this game.
Sit down, Lord. If you are tired, how can you sit down if you have nothing to sit down on? You say yes, Brother Farrakhan, but that is the Bible. I'm not finished with the Bible yet. The Bible said Moses walked with him and spoke with him face to face as a man speaketh to his friend. all throughout the scriptures of the Bible. We're not dealing with some spook or formless spirit. We're dealing with a man. Well, what about the Holy Quran? The Holy Quran is not dealing with a man. No. Huh? But the Quran uses the personal pronoun I. I belongs to who? Talk back to me. The Holy Quran uses the soft pronoun we. Does God have associates? Does he have partners? Why say we? If God himself revealed the book, he knows best the language. Why did he use the language of a human being? These attributes of the Quran are not the attributes of a spirit. He's beneficent. He's merciful. He's powerful. He's the life giver, the sustainer, the securer, the destroyer. Spirits don't do that. Men in whom the spirit dwells do that. Who is God?
That's how powerful the minister is, man. Like, when he speaks, you be quiet.
Yeah, man. Shout out to, you know, Louis Farrakhan and the Nation. You know, definitely a man who's always been about, you know, getting out there and just telling it like it is.
No doubt, man. And with our guest tonight, being a huge contributor to our community, whatever it be on the hip-hop side, whether it be uplifting our community, being there for the youth, dropping the game that he's been dropping in his music, doing talent showcases, and alongside being a part of history, pivotal history, with the late Tupac Shakur and Khalid Muhammad, let's all welcome Young Con to Don in the building.
What's good with it, family? Man, I'm honored and privileged to be on a show like this. Y'all representing to the fullest, doing your thing, man, and I'm honored that y'all took the time out to call me and chop it up with me. People have reached out to me, but I was selective in who I would talk to, and I decided that y'all would be the one, so let's get it cracking.
God body man, represent, man. Peace to you, man. Brother. Thank you for joining us, man. We truly were so humbled by your presence, so we appreciate your appearance, man. Thank you so much.
Oh, man, I'm just ready to dive into it, and even though I haven't met y'all in person, we definitely have met in spirit, so that's what it's all about anyway.
Definitely, man.
Hey, man, and when we dive into it, man, the first thing I wanted to shoot to you about is, how's the YouTube channel going with you, man? Because that's how I found you.
Oh, you know what's interesting? Yeah, the interesting thing is, prior to that Tupac video that I uploaded, the channel was pretty dormant, and I had decided that I was going to put some attention on it to grow it. And I had that video in my possession probably for the last 10 years. But I never saw anybody else with it online. I never saw anything outside of the minute or so clip that was in the movie Resurrection. And being that I was a part of that history and instrumental in helping to facilitate Tupac and Brother Khalid being there on the panel, along with my mentor, who was also seated on the panel, known as Brother James 2X, or the Five-Star General, I felt that it was just that time to share what I had with the world, not knowing that I would be the first one to do it.
Hmm. Well, one thing about it, Khan, is when you're looking at, Dr. Muhammad and Tupac, you know, these are two of the most, if there is any singular or or for this case, duo of black nationalism and, you know, always being about the freedom of our people, it would be those individuals right there. And me and King chop it up on the air and off air a lot about that meeting. I mean, that was like, do we have any appropriate adjectives that can appropriately give justice to how monumental it was for that But before we actually get into that meeting, how did you find yourself becoming, a soldier and the fighter for us in terms of becoming, the man of principle and stature that you are, doing what you do?
Well, that's a good question. And I would say from my early teenage years, I was always curious and intrigued about why everywhere I looked and I saw us as black people, we seemed to be at the bottom of the social ladder. And everywhere I saw saw Caucasians, they always seemed to be on top of the ground. You know, they had the best schools, the most money, the nicest cars, the best communities. And it just disturbed my consciousness. And I wonder why we were in the condition that we were in. And me being a true artist since I was a teenager as well in the rap game, at that time I was studying whoever I considered to be the best in the game at that time, which during that era, it would have been Kumo D, Rakim, and Big Daddy Kane, in my humble opinion. And so Kumo D had an album out at that time called Knowledge is King. And he also had a song on there. And one of the lines in the song was, they party and dance and they don't ever glance at a book or look for their minds to advance. They caught in a rut, chasing butt, trying to get a dollar or a nut. Evil feeds off the source of apathy, weaken the mind, and of course you have to be less than a man, more like a thing, no knowledge of nothing. Knowledge is king. And those bars inspired me to not want to be who he was talking about. So I found myself at the mall a week or so later, and I went into a bookstore, and they had the small section in the back. I mean, real small, about the size of a bookshelf. That was the black African-American section or whatever you want to call it. And I saw this book with Malcolm X's face on the cover. And that book intrigued me. And so I bought the book. And once I bought the book, I couldn't put it down. And it just answered so many questions about why we were in the condition that we were in. And I hadn't seen anybody as fierce and as revolutionary as Malcolm X was. And I realized that he had a teacher. But it was in the early 90s at this point, and I was like, man, well, where is somebody? We need somebody like that on the scene today. And my girlfriend at the time knew I was into, quote, unquote, that black stuff, and she decided to give me for my birthday a book called Message to the Black Man, a subscription to the Chronicle newspaper.
By Elijah Muhammad,
By the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a subscription to the Final Call newspaper, and tickets for me and her to go hear Minister Louis Farrakhan live and in person. And
now,
I was blown away.
Now,
from that point on, I just said that I was with it.
You know, definitely, Con, because we got a couple hours of kicking, man. And, of course, that book you have Malcolm X cover, ostensibly we would assume that that was the autobiography of Malcolm X that you picked up.
Absolutely.
Because, this is going to be a show tonight, because it's going to go a lot of different places in terms of race, class, perception, current events that go on right now. Disclaimer to our listeners out there, we're not out to offend anybody. But we're telling y'all in advance, we could go some places, so you may want to buckle up for this.
But, hey, the truth don't hurt nobody but the guilty.
Amen to that.
The truth is going to be what it is. So, if I come under the wings of Khalid and what you saw of Tupac in that speech, you should already know. Now, I know how to be politically correct. I know how to be diplomatic. But the truth is going to be the truth regardless to who likes it or who don't believe it or whatever it is. It doesn't change the facts. So something I always say is fight these facts. Regardless how you feel, can you fight the facts? And if you can't fight the facts, and I know you can't,
then the best thing you can do is submit while you got time.
That's game right there, and that's
always
powerful because I remember. Yeah, I remember watching the documentary on Richard Pryor, Roadmap to Logic, and Paul Mooney said it best: the truth defends itself. So,
in that,
we'll
in
go
that
ahead
order.
And, yes. So I guess we're going to get into it from there. So, what was it like for you to see, the Honorable, Farrakhan, Minister Louis Farrakhan speak for the first time in terms of how it really transformed you to open up your perspective in a broader panoramic context of what is going on with the plight of African Americans, and just Black America, Black men in general all over the world, our plight, the Black man, the Black woman, and the Black child.
Well, before I saw him in person, my father
mm-hmm.
brought home a compilation VHS tape that had a documentary on it called Eyes on the Prize.
Mm. Yes.
And it also had a couple of clips of Minister Farrakhan talking about a white man's heaven is a Black man's hell in there. And one day, one Saturday or something, I happened to be turning the channel, and I saw this Black man playing a violin. And that sparked my interest further, for one, because I've never seen a Black person playing the violin with that level of skill.
And you're talking about Farrakhan, correct?
Correct. He was on a show called the Bobby Jones Gospel Hour. Now, I'm a teenager.
Yeah.
And so I saw him playing his violin. And my mother walked in the room, and I said, "Ma, who you ever seen this man before? Who is this?" She said, "Oh, that's Farrakhan. White people don't like him. They banned him from coming to Indianapolis," which they didn't actually ban him. But in her mind, his reputation had preceded him that Caucasian people didn't particularly care for him. And so
right.
that just really, blew my top, if you will. Not so much as him playing the violin, but whatever Bobby Jones asked him, he was so articulate that I was
mm-hmm.
impressed. And then my father brought home, like I said, this video, and he was on the Phil Donahue show, which was an old talk show back in the day. And, man, he was handling every question in a very intelligent, diplomatic, but truthful, uncompromising way. And when I saw him,
right.
I said, this is the closest thing to Malcolm X that I read in the book that I have seen. I wish I could meet him. And sure
mm-hmm.
enough, when my girlfriend brought me those tickets for my birthday, which happens to be coincidentally June 16th, the exact same birthday as Tupac Shakur.
Tupac's birthday, yes. Yes.
June 16th. I was June 16th, 1970, and he's June 16th, 1971.
Oh, wow.
So, right. Go figure, right? And so we went, and to go a little deeper than that, my wife, her birthday is on Biggie's birthday, and my birthday is Tupac's birthday.
March 9th.
Wow. No, he died.
Wow.
Biggie died on March
9th. Oh, no.
His birthday,
you're right, March 9th. You're right. Yeah, you're right.
My birthday was May 19th.
Yes, exactly. Yes,
so she's
yes.
born on Biggie's birthday, and I'm born on Tupac's birthday.
Oh, man, that's crazy. Oh, wow.
That's super crazy.
That's
and we both doing
right
music.
There.
She's singing. I'm rapping. She's singing. We together making the music
mm-hmm.
that we're making. But anyway, that was just, I thought, an interesting fact.
No, please. This is very interesting. Please, keep going.
And so when I went to the convention center with my girlfriend at that time to go see the
mm-hmm.
minister, I remember seeing this long line of clean-shaven, sharply dressed Black men, all in suits. And I had never seen that many Black people in a suit at one time. And one of the guys that I saw in the suit, he was about 6'4". He had the stature or the physical stature of like Suge Knight. and he used to play for the New York Giants. His name then was James Metlock, or James 2X. He played for the Giants, and he was a teammate of Lawrence Taylor, and he was being coached by Bill Parcell at the time. And little did I know, a month or so later, after I saw the minister give this speech called Add It Up, What Does America Owe the Black Man?
Right.
I couldn't sleep the rest of the night, but I just remember saying to myself when I saw the minister speak that he needs some help, and I wish that I could help him. And a couple of months later, I was going to what was called the Indiana Black Expo, the same Indiana Black Expo 3 years later that we had Tupac at. And there was a guy, my mentor, Minister James, was handing out flyers to a bookstore that was going to be opening. And at the bottom of this flyer, it had Minister Farrakhan audio and video tapes. So I saved the flyer for 2 months until the store opened. When the store opened, I went in. I didn't even speak to him and ask him how he was doing. I just walked in the door and said, what do I need to do to join the Nation of Islam? And he tore off a sheet of paper and told me where to come and meet up at that following Friday. And I've been rolling ever since. And that's how the story starts.
That's what it is. And when you're talking about the men dressed very sharply and very, you know, in the business fashion, that would be the FOI, Fruit of Islam, correct?
No doubt about it.
Got you. And got you.
I was just fascinated because I didn't know that it could even be that many of us clean and on our square and being competitive in a world where all I saw was us in a hood setting, either smoking or drinking or struggling. But, man, this group of guys, they seem to have just been on top of it all across the board. So that was attractive to me, and I wanted to reflect that.
Yeah. You know, and it's something when you look at – go ahead, King, go ahead.
Plus, what I think the fascination with a lot of brothers, because around that time you also had Public Enemy – they were using a lot of excerpts from the Nation of Islam as well as Farrakhan, and they also made the Nation and being militant look very hip. That was the appeal that they had.
And interestingly enough, as I later learned, as I became a member of the Nation and traveled throughout the world doing security for people from everybody from Tupac to Kanye West to the minister himself, Jay-Z, DMX, Mystical, you name them, I have had the opportunity and the blessing to be in those guys' presence and to secure them. But the audience, when they would do their shows, it was always mind-boggling to me that 95% of those in the audience of Public Enemy and all these black groups were white people.
Yeah, they were white.
And I said, we always talking about keeping it hood. But the ones that are listening and being affected by the live shows are these young white teenagers, male and female. And I just thought that that was a paradox and a contradiction.
I thought that was pretty strange because it's music that's going against, you know, speaking against the criminal acts that white people have committed in the midst of time. But yet they're pretty much cheering and they're pretty much buying the records. I thought that was pretty bizarre.
Yeah, but it also showed that there is a new mindset that is coming in. And even Malcolm X, when he was alive and on the scene, he used to debate with people at Harvard and Yale and those so-called prestigious universities of lower learning. He would go there addressing those white students, and he would come back and tell the brothers that he's doing that because tomorrow those same people that he was addressing would be the lawyers and the judges and the policemen and the doctors. So he was planting the seed of the plight of the black man's struggle in the heads of those more liberal-minded Caucasians, if you will. And so we saw the offspring of that in those people's children, those are the people's children that you would see at a Public Enemy concert or NWA or a Tupac show.
You know, and you know, Khan, so that situation, what you just said in terms of, you know, what you and King were speaking on, the paradox of it and the irony, you know, we to really give, I think, full appreciation to it, we have to look at the impetus of where hip-hop culture started in earnest. You know, some would say even James Brown was one of the first original rappers in terms of how he set his song structure with his ad-libs, but this is going further into with The Last Poets, with Gil Scott-Heron, and of course, you know, going on tours with Sugar Hill Gang and then going into the 80s, you know, as it progressed, African Bambaataa, of course, gave it its name. But when you're looking at the history of hip-hop culture, rap, music, you know, was birthed out of the plight of the struggles of the Latin and Black brothers in the inner city. And this was our outlet, which you could say in its merits was speaking out against the very system that tried to oppress us.
Absolutely.
And it's funny. And it's funny because when you look at it, too, rock and roll was the same thing, was the same outlet for rebellious white youth. You know, I mean, they used to go crazy. I mean, parents thought it was like the worst thing in the world when Elvis was shaking his pelvis out there. But, you know, but the kids loved it. And, you know, of course, as it went to heavy metal, you know, in the 70s, you know, where you would have bands like Led Zeppelin, you know, Black Sabbath later on. I think the
Leonard
paradox.
Skinner.
Yes, sir. Leonard Skinner. Oh, man. Yeah. I'm a avowed metalhead as well as a hip hop, you know, child of hip hop. Yeah,
right.
So it's like, and all those bands. So you see where a lot of times the similarities are more brings us together than what sets us apart. Because I think a lot of times, too, especially from the rock side and heavy metal side, heavy metal going back to, because a lot of people don't know when and how the parental advisory stickers came on the albums. And I'm going somewhere with this. And you know this as well as King probably does. And it goes back to, I believe, 1984 and Al Gore's wife, Tipper. The whole parents against, you know, I think it was the
obscenity.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, thank you. And that was because their daughter had received a Prince, I believe it was the Purple Rain album, and it had the song "Darling Nikki." We all saw the movie and we heard the song. So,
right.
We know how. So then she was such a shock that she was like, "Oh my God, this is." And this is how that all came up. So we saw a situation where from Black music and Black culture, how white children, as you said, were beginning to understand us, because that old guard from the 30s, 40s, and 50s, where everything was considered so homogenized and where Black people were marginalized, you know, we look at a lot of Black and white freedom fighters that were killed. You know, of course, the movie Mississippi Burning was one of the, you know, with Gene Hackman starring, was one of the most poignant, you know, films. Of course, you know, Medgar Evers, you know, Malcolm X, Dr. King, you know, even John F. Kennedy, who introduced the Civil Rights Bill but was assassinated before he had a chance to sign into law, which ultimately Lyndon B. Johnson was signed in 64. So we've had a lot of, so there's been a lot. And to see where our voice, no matter how much society has tried to shun us, to see how we still broke through and it still found its lane. And Khan, you know, this is like the biggest thing back in the day when, and shout out to Edward Furlong from Terminator 2. Remember most prevalently in that movie where he wore a Public Enemy T-shirt?
Right.
Exactly. So it shows you how far that appeal from what we started has gone. And it has reached a lot, you know, and I think a lot of times from where metal music and hip-hop was is cut from the same culture. People who felt disenfranchised and wanted to express themselves. And I think somewhere along the line, white people found a kinship with us with that. Now, I guess we're probably, depending on where we go with the conversation, we're probably going to get into it later about how the music has changed and not all in a good way and who's, you know, dictating which way the culture is going. But watch it. Yeah, exactly. Culture vultures. Thank you, King. But yeah, man. So, I mean, as you saw this on tours, because all the artists that you did security for, the places you've been, how many did you find of white people did you interact with that you found actually had a real appreciation for the culture and its rich history rather than those who kind of just looked at it as a fad that they just wanted to be the cool kids to be a part of it?
Believe it or not, nearly all of the majority of Caucasians that I came in contact with, they see the hip-hop artists. They literally bow at their feet like gods, from Snoop Dogg to Tupac to Biggie to Lauryn Hill. I've seen this with my own eyes. I've been on the Stephen Colbert show with Snoop Dogg. I've been on that the Wendy Williams show securing him. I've been at, when it was hot, 106 in Park with Snoop Dogg. Martha Stewart show, The View. And Snoop has fans from 8 years old to 80. I don't care where you go in the world, they know who Snoop Dogg is. They might not
know. Shout out to Uncle Snoop.
They might not know who Joe Biden is, but they know who Snoop Dogg is.
Yes, sir.
And,
yes, sir.
But these smart, crooked deceivers have always capitalized on our struggle, because our struggle emanates, of course, with them enslaving us, and it's always been about economics. So if they could figure out a way to put our struggle in a bottle or put it in a movie or put it in a song, and they
and
could distribute it and market it, they're going to monetize every single aspect of our struggle from the time we're born to after the time of our death. And they often make more money on us dead after they have milked us like cows out in the field. We generate money even while we're dead and in the grave. They're still making deposits into their bank accounts long after we're gone, because we have not been wise enough to control our own content, to control our intellectual property, to control our vision and keep it in our own hand without compromising, all while being in pursuit of what looks like this illusion of the American dream. And so that's how we end up losing out. Even when you look at a person like Ice Cube when he came from NWA, I know we're going to be bouncing around, like I said, but we're just chopping it up.
It's okay.
And I'm going to give as much free game as I can within the time that I'm on the podcast to make sure that this is one that they want to go back and listen to. So I'm going to drop as many tidbits as I can. But when you just look at the transition, let's say of Ice Cube.
Yes, sir.
Ice Cube was with NWA. And he came out with these songs. I don't know to what degree of profanity y'all can use on the podcast, but they had songs on
there. Sir, this is off the cuff. Say whatever the fuck you feel.
Hey, in that order. They had songs like A Bitch is a Bitch, She Swallowed It, The World's Biggest Dick. All of that was cool.
Right.
But when that man got wise to what Jerry Heller was doing in manipulating him and the group members of NWA, and they were making this money for Jerry Heller, and they had never seen that kind of money, and Jerry Heller put royalty checks in front of them, or checks for $75,000 each, I think.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That was from
but
the movie.
But they couldn't cash the check.
Right.
They couldn't cash the check until they signed the contract. So
right.
just think of how much money had been made that they did not even know about if each one of them could be written a $75,000 check.
Yeah.
So
and you know,
Ice Cube,
you know, go ahead.
No,
I was just gonna say. Yeah, go ahead. I'll go after you go. Go ahead.
When Ice Cube saw that there was a hand in the cookie jar, and he wanted to look further into it, and he said, "No, I'm good. I'm gonna pass up on this $75,000. Y'all keep this. The paperwork got to be right, etc." And when he went solo and started his album Death Certificate,
and disrespectfully, just for clarification, now what happened was Death Certificate was the second album released in 1991. The
After
funk
Killer
between
Will.
No, Killer Will was the EP. Killer Will was the EP. His first album was America's Most Wanted, released in 1990, that had the Bomb Squad, you know, which was Republic Enemy's recording production crew with him. And as you said, Khan, the issues came because what you said is accurate in terms of the business discrepancies, because for those who saw the movie, a lot of that was, you know, we've talked with people and we've had respectful discussions about the validity of it. From what I knew, that movie was about 90% accurate in terms of the story as I knew it. But as
absolutely
you said, you know,
correct.
But the situation in terms of what happened, you know, and I'm also going to say this too before we go further, before I lose my train of thought. Whatever we go subject you want to go to, if we bounce around like a ping pong, it is okay. This is off the cuff. That's what we do. We talk about everything. So wherever you want to take it, we can go there. So what happened was in that situation, because the issues came down to what was going on first between Easy and Jerry. Now, Easy's finances from the street was what birthed Ruthless Records. There was always a point of consternation about it because, as you said, it was about what they were all getting, because it seemed like Easy was getting the most of it because him and Jerry had the closest relationship. We're not even talking about what happened when Dre found out how much he wasn't getting from his production credits. And Dre will tell you this. Dre had house, I believe it was in Calabasas, California. Dre will tell you he had a big ass mansion but no furniture. You know, and when Cube got wise to it, that scene in the movie, shout out to O'Shea, you know, Cube Jr., you know, when they had that scene. Yes, he did.
Oh, yeah.
When him and you know, when they're having that discussion and he's saying, you know, and Jerry, you know, coming to him with that money, and he's like, "But Jerry, that's my money anyway." He's like, "Why are you doing this?" He's like, "You know, none of us know what it is with these contracts. You know, we don't know what none of this. I don't know what none of this language means. None of us know what this means."
Right.
And because that's when Cube started realizing that the money was not right, and Cube was the only one that never signed a group contract. So Cube just left. He wrote for them. He got some money out of it, but he didn't get all the money he was supposed to get, which is why he ended up leaving and then going solo and ended up. But he had already made such a presence with them from Straight Outta Compton, because, you know, Khan, it's crazy because for all the situations, because, of course, NWA's album, NWA and the Posse, was released in 1986. Straight Outta Compton was released in 1988. And still with Straight Outta Compton, for the NWA that we all grew up listening to, that is still the only album that all of them were together. You know, when he left, they dropped Niggas for Life in 1991. And that was when they did the, you know, Benedict Arnold track, you know, because they scattered Cube disses throughout. And then Cube ended it later that year in 1991 with Death Certificate, where he dropped No Vaseline.
He definitely burned the house down with that one.
But and everyone said, well, Cube smoked them because they never came back. Well, that's true. But that's also the same year Dre and all them found out that what Cube was saying was right, that the business was not correct, because Dre would end up leaving and starting, you know, meeting up with a guy Yeah. Well, no. It wasn't Aftermath. That wasn't Aftermath yet. This was 1991. So what happened is he would end up meeting a guy who was a bodyguard at the time with Bobby Brown by the name of Suge Knight. They would eventually start a label that was initially called Future Shock Records before it became Death Row Records. And, of course, we know all the history after that, but that's a whole separate story. But, yeah, man. But Q, as you saw, like you said, as you saw him make the transition when he would go from being that guy, you know, who was on the outside looking in, to he had his own lane. And when Q took off, oh, my God, he ran with it. I mean, this dude dropped an album for 4 straight years.
It just goes to show you how a lot of these labels, they always create that divide and conquer tactic to break up many groups.
Yeah.
And it takes me to the point that I was making in bringing Ice Cube up in his evolution. Just like Malcolm in his evolution went from a hustler to being locked up to getting enlightened. And when he got enlightened, he became more of a liability and more dangerous because he wasn't living the lifestyle of an everyday dead Negro or somebody just out in the hood scratching and surviving. Once the light turned on for Malcolm, just like it did for Ice Cube, white people understood, or the powers that be understood, this man, if we don't stop him, because he had linked up with Brother Khalid on his albums. Khalid was on Death Certificate. He was rotating with Public Enemy. So you cannot get away. I always say this. I don't care how you slice it up. You cannot separate Elijah Muhammad, the Nation of Islam, and Louis Farrakhan's influence and impact on hip-hop music as we know it. If you take those elements away, you would not have hip-hop even in its degraded state that it is now, had it not been for that wisdom. When Cube hooked up with the Bomb Squad and Chuck D and all of them, you're still dealing with that NOI influence.
Yes, sir.
And
most
so
definitely.
They saw that Ice Cube evolved from Death Certificate. Then he went, what was the album that came after Death Certificate?
Well, it was the Predator. Well, it was the Predator, and then Lethal Injection.
When he got to Lethal Injection, they said, he's not going to stop. So we have to do this. We have to offer him and give him what he's asking for, which he was transitioning into film. Right?
Yes, sir.
So they started giving him money, and they shot the movie Friday in a 20-day time span. Nobody expected it to do anything, and it became a cult classic, and it launched him into another stratosphere of impact. So they took the most dangerous gangstered out rapper to now Ice Cube is known for family movies, like they said in the movie or the cartoon Boondocks on the Gangsta Liquors episode.
Oh,
he said, you know who I admired when I was coming up? Ice Cube. And Lil Riley said, you mean, what's Riley's brother's name in
who?
The cartoon?
The guy that does family movies?
Who?
Yeah, it was Riley. Yeah, he said, you mean the guy that does family movies? So they literally took all of the militancy out of Ice Cube, and they watered him down to where when you think about him, you don't think about the Death Certificate, the Predator, or Lethal Injection Ice Cube. You think of the Friday Ice Cube, the Friday After Next, the Are We There Yet Ice Cube. That's the Ice Cube you think about now. So they're either going to castrate you, they're going to water you down, or they're going to eliminate you. And that is going to bring us full circle to Tupac as we continue the conversation.
Yes, sir. And
that's a great segue to bring up Tupac, man, because he also had a slogan, not a slogan, but a quote that I heard on Kendrick Lamar's album, on Immortal Man, where he said that by the time black males reach their 30s, it's like they lose their fight. Do you see that as being true?
Absolutely, because just look at him. Look at his album, Tupacalypse Now, Strictly for My Niggas. Okay,
yeah.
He was always a forward-thinking, him being the offspring of his mother being involved with the Black Panther Party. And, again, the Black Panther Party became, they were also known as the Children of Malcolm.
Mm-hmm.
So they liked the philosophies of the nation, but they did not necessarily like the disciplinary aspect of the nation. And this is how they came
right.
up with the 10-point program, et cetera, et cetera. And the militancy side of it, they didn't like the fact that they couldn't carry weapons, which ultimately ended up being their demise in the long run. But Tupac, being spawning from that, like Caucasians spawned a new generation of Caucasians because of this message coming through television, coming through print media, coming through cable programs. This is what sparked a new idea and a new way of thinking. So when Tupac, who saw his mother suffer the way that she did, he was conflicted between being a radical and a revolutionary for his people and this person that everybody gets along with. He was very intelligent. He was bright. He was well-read.
Yes, he was.
He was knowledgeable. He was mature beyond his age, and he was a teenager. It's enough information and video content out on YouTube and different outlets to where you could see the brilliance of Tupac as a very young man. Well, Tupac is only a sign of the brilliance that is present in today's 16 and 17-year-olds and 15-year-olds. Only they are even more, they're further along psychologically in how they reason and how they think on the one side of the coin. But on the other side, because of that level of intelligence and common enemy knows what the ultimate fate will be for them as an enemy. They say, like the scripture says, come let us deal wisely with them before they multiply with an enemy of ours. And we don't have any more control over them. So we used to get young blacks with church. We used to get them with school, but they not really going to school. They not going to church. So the best way that we can get them now is through entertainment. We can literally reshape their minds, their psyche, and even their DNA by what we put on the big screen, in the music, on the radio stations. We are able to transform and weaken them and water them down. If y'all can think back, y'all should be old enough when the show In Living Color was on. And they used
to
have a segment called, and they had a segment where it was called Men on Film.
Right.
Where David Alan Greer
and
Damon Wayans, they would play these homosexuals reviewing movies. Right?
Right.
And we thought that that was so funny at the time, because homosexuality amongst black men was not just flaming everywhere like sunshine is shining everywhere now. And it was entertaining, so we thought. But you fast forward 20, 30 years later, those same two characters are now commonplace in our society.
Now,
it's not just
you,
men on film now.
Right. And
it's,
you know,
men,
it's
in reality.
And that's real, because I want, before I get to this next question, I wanted to speak on that, because we all come from a generation, you know, it's not of us being older, because, you know, the fact is we are children of that culture of hip hop. So we love it unconditionally. You know, we grew
Correct.
Up in an era where, as you said, you know, Khan, the music we listened to coming up, You know, I mean, you know, my favorite artist growing up, as I really got into it, was, of course, Cube, Cool G Rap, Ice-T, NWA, Scarface, Cam.
No question.
You know, King T, you know, MC Light, Yo-Yo, Rap.
It was
Forte,
variety.
E-40. Yes, yes.
It was like going to a buffet where you could get a little bit of this, you get a little De La Soul, you could season it and sprinkle it with a little Jungle Brothers. If you wanted a flavor unit, you could get NWA, you could get Heavy D and the Boys, you could get Biz Markie, you could get Ice-T, you could get a little Tupac, Too Short, and all of them could be on the same tour together.
And the thing was also, too, radio was not corporate like it is now, because back in the day, the DJs had the opportunity. They could play whatever they wanted. You know, it was not a playlist. It was just, if the song was out, it just happened to come out and the song hit, that's what you played. But the DJs had an opportunity to really just play what they knew was good. And now, because, you know, with radio becoming so corporate, with Clear Channel, iHeart, and all that, and now with them, because you know this as well as King and I do, Con, because back in the day there was a P word which was absolutely taboo, and that was called payola. You didn't, a DJ never even thought about taking money from a record label to play an album if it wasn't good.
You can buy your way to the number one spot. They tell you outright. There was just a conference on P. Diddy's Revolt channel where they did the Revolt conference, and you can look at the CEOs of Quality Control Music that puts out Migos, that puts out City Girls, Lil Yachty. Coincidentally, one of the CEOs, Coach K, he's from Indianapolis just like I am. And when I was a young soldier in the nation, I used to take bean pies to Coach K's house personally.
He's from Gary, correct?
No, he's from Indianapolis.
Okay, Indianapolis. Okay, got you.
And I thought that was so funny. Speaking of coincidences again, that 10 years later, after he moved from Indianapolis to Atlanta, the next time saw him was in a magazine as Young Jeezy's manager.
Yes,
and I said, wait a minute,
I
used to take bean pies to this man's house.
Yeah.
And now he was with Young Jeezy, who was one of the biggest guys out in the game at that time. And I saw Coach K, and then you forward it again, and he's with the City Girls and Migos and all of this Quality Control Music. But my point was that they said in this Revolt conference, and you can look it up on YouTube, they said that if you want to break a record, honestly speaking, you're going to need about $200,000. You got $200,000, you can have a number one record.
Yeah, because they're going to play it. Because that money, once it's deposited, that goes to all the playlists, and everybody gets their cut off of it.
And the cuts are even smaller because of streaming now. It ain't like it was even with a CD or a tape. The portion of the pie was a little bit bigger, but now with streaming, they taking everything.
I just had a conversation with a former group member of mine today, and he has his album on Tidal.
Yes, sir.
And he sent me this picture that shows how much all of these streaming sites will pay you for their music in an era where everything is streaming and the hard copies have basically become dinosaurs and died off. But what a lot of people don't understand is there's still money in physical hard copies of your music. If you can get in front of an audience, 67% of the American public does not consume their music online. 67%. So who is marketing to that demographic?
Right.
But we as artists who are following the yellow brick road, if you will, and what we see, we think that all you got to do is put your stuff on YouTube and you gonna make it. When in reality, YouTube is only going to pay you about $2,000 for every million streams that you get.
$2,000.
If you could give us a quick
down.
Yeah, if you could give us a quick mathematics, because I know YouTube a few years ago started paying artists in terms of how many views do you actually have to hit to get started getting paid? Because I heard it was like 50,000. After 50,000, you get paid. I've heard after 100,000, you get paid. Where does that number start before you start getting money from it?
Here's what you need for all those independent aspiring artists. The first thing you need is 1,000 subscribers.
Got you.
Now,
got you.
You need 1,000 subscribers, and you need 4,000 hours of viewing time on your channel. Then you become eligible to receive a payout after you get so many views each month. But the first hurdle you got to overcome is 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 hours of viewing time. So how do you get that in today's climate where music is being dropped literally 24 hours a day? And then when you get to that point, YouTube is only going to pay you about $5 per 100,000 views. So let's just dispel this rumor. Here is what the streaming sites are paying right now. Napster pays 1 cent per stream. Tidal pays 1 penny per stream. Apple Music does not even pay you a half of a penny or barely a half a penny. Google Play pays you about a half a penny. Spotify pays you less than half a penny. Amazon pays you less than half a penny. And Pandora pays you less than half of a penny, and YouTube is the worst of them all. But for you to make minimum wage as an artist from streaming in today's climate, just to make minimum wage, which is $14.72 on average a month, you need to have 2,100,333 streams a month to make $1,472.
You took your time breaking down those numbers, didn't you, Khan?
Hey, look, when you go a step further than that, King, you need that many streams, 2 million streams a month, to make $368 a week.
You know, Khan, those numbers you broke down that was mind blowing how you did all the mathematics for that. And this is one thing me and King have always talked about, because there is, and you know, Khan, this is one thing too that we didn't even mention. This is not even talking about the licensing online for some of that music, because there is a lot of stuff out there, a lot of hip-hop, just R&B, rock and roll, that's not even licensed, you won't even be able to find online. And that's why, to me, as you said, you know, and I think King agrees with me as well, that's why physical copies are still an integral part of the culture, because that is the one thing. There's nothing like having it in your hand, because it's something, this the tangible piece of it that you really, really, really can say you are really a fan. You've actually went out and bought that $15 CD. And once again, how labels distribute the funds is questionable, because not everybody gets the same rate of compensation for royalties when we talk about mechanical and all of that. But yes, but it's like, you know, I've always implored artists, you know, always keep those physicals out there, because, as you said, there are people who will buy it. I know I will.
Absolutely. And just think, so my friend and group member that I was talking to today, he said, well, Khan, my streaming, he asked me about my music, is the majority of it available on streaming? I said, no, it's not. But you can get the links to the downloads from me from that aspect. I said, but I know he's on Tidal, and he has a combined 22,000 streams. I said, how much money have you made from 22,000 streams? He said, about $400. I said, that sounds about right. I said,
yeah,
I would rather sell 100 copies of a CD to 100 people at $10 a CD and make $1,000.
Make a hundred. Yeah.
Then 22,000 streams and make 400. I said,
and it's crazy.
No matter how big, I'm sorry, no matter how big,
go ahead.
We like to think that, I said, which one is more important to you? Everybody knowing your music or you being able to go to the bank and make a deposit? He said, well, both. I said, I agree. But where should your focus be? Your focus should be on what generates you the most money while still maintaining your independence and your creativity and control over your content. I said, so guess what? And I'm going to give y'all podcast free game right now.
Mm-hmm.
You can put a QR code and make it as a direct link to your music, whether it's your Google Drive or your Dropbox or whatever, right? You make a QR code that sends your fan directly to your Dropbox account or your Google Play account or whatever you have to where you can share the file. If you made 1,000 business cards with that QR code on the card and you sold that card for $10 a card and all they got to do is scan it and it's on their device, you could make $10,000. From 1,000 business cards. And all you have to do is divide 1,000 business cards by 12 months. And that will give you a realistic target goal of how many of those cards you would need to sell a month to make $10,000 or $20,000 or $50,000, whatever your personal goals are. That was just free game. Y'all don't have to pay me nothing for that. But that is definitely a way to go in 2019 because a lot of these artists are drinking the Kool-Aid and under this mist, they're hypnotized by this mist that because your stuff is online, that means you're getting paid. I do open mics and shows all the time where artists will get up there and say, yeah, this is artist, this is MC Nobody, and my stuff is available and streaming on all platforms. But nobody in the audience is even going to remember your name long enough to type it into their phone to find where your music is at.
You know, Khan, there's so much you said that is just absolutely true. Because what you have in a situation is when we look at the paradigm of how music has been moved these days, you know, back in the day, We got to look at the genesis of when hip hop really started coming. Of course, with Def Jam, you know, really being it wasn't the first hip hop label, but it was the first hip hop label that really took off. And of course, this is before, you know, this is before the corporate entities got in it. So you had labels like Tough City, Sleeping Bag Records, you know,
Profile Records.
Yes. Yes, all those labels. Yes, sir. And this was devoid. Go ahead.
I was going to say, do you know that people don't even realize that when Run DMC, who was the top, who was the Migos of their day?
Yes, they were.
When Run DMC had the album Raising Hell out, and they were going triple platinum, the label Profile Records that they were on only had 8 employees.
So everybody was eating.
DJ Quick was on Profile Records. Run DMC was on Profile Records, and they literally had 8 employees. Houdini signed their first contract for $2,000. One of the groups that have the worst recording contract in the history of hip-hop music is Public Enemy.
You know, and that's crazy because, you know, that was because I remember seeing Griff years ago when he spoke, and Griff spoke about the situations that went on at Def Jam with the time in terms of Public Enemy, because, of course, with Russell Simmons, he called him Hustle Simmons, you know. But, you know, it's ironic because with Public Enemy, from their debut with Bum Rush the Show, I believe that came out in 86 or 87. Then, of course, 87. You would have It Takes a – yeah, 87, and it would take a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back. I believe that was 88. Then you have Fear of a Black Planet, and that was, and then, of course, you know, Apocalypse 91, The Enemy Strikes Black. And then, of course, you know, Music in Our Message that was released in 1994. But Public Enemy was just one of – it's ironic that you say that because Public Enemy was, you know, especially during that 80s era of the pro-black African, you know, movement where you had, you know, KRS-One, Harmony, Ms. Melody, you know, like you said, the Native Tongues, Brand Nubian, you know, during that 80s and 90s era, you know, the music was revolutionary. It was all about, you know, community. It was about upliftment from the West Coast. Yeah. Yeah. When you had West Coast All-Stars doing We're All in the Same Gang, it seemed like it was just a movement. And then, you know, it just, but yeah, but that whole thing with Public Enemy, what was going on with that contract specifically as to, you know, the robbery behind it?
Well, I mean, it's just a classic case. The same thing that the music industry has been doing forever, where they
right.
control the publishing. They put these advances out to record
mm-hmm.
an album, and they lock you in for 4 or 5 albums, and they
right.
drive you into debt with these hidden costs that you know nothing about. So if they ship
yeah.
a million records on you, 20% of those million, which is 200,000, can
yes,
be
sir.
Written off as damaged or promotional goods. Meanwhile, they're giving those 200,000 copies to little mom and pop record stores at that time, you know, in the payola game. They're just giving away merch or selling it under the table. You don't know how many
right.
is being printed up. You have no way to track it. And so they write off 20% and then they pay you on the 800,000. But out of the 800,000, they're going to still keep money on return goods.
Right.
They're going to keep money on goods that did not sell. But they're charging you for what they shipped, which is a million.
Mm.
So when it's time for you to pay taxes, it's going to show that you sold a million records.
You got to
pay
that tax on a million records.
Exactly. And by the time you look up, you so far in the hole off of your first album, they're splitting the video cost with you 50% down the middle, and you got to pay your 50% based on your royalty rate, which if you don't own the publishing, your points may be 2-3 pennies on the dollar.
Oh, my God. Ooh.
So by the time the second album comes out, you're so hungry and thirsty as an artist who – experienced this blow up of apparent success, not to mention if you got a drug problem or weed or, you know, women are your weakness, and now you're on the road, you're on tour, you're getting girls every night, you sleeping in these hotels, not knowing that they deducting all of that from your budget, that you got to pay them back upon receipt of your royalties.
Yeah.
You got to pay the attorney. You got to pay the manager. You got to pay the stylist. You got to reimburse them for all that whining and dining that they did at your expense. Plus the tax, the 35 to 40% tax bracket. So you don't realize that out of $1 million, $600,000 might be yours, depending on what you own of the content and the publishing.
But they're going to take all
gotta get it set.
And not to mention the
sample. Yeah.
Not to mention the sampling.
So Ice Cube said it best. He said, the stage is the corner. The artist is the hope.
And the label is the pimp.
And the fan is the Johns or the Tricks. And the label is the pimp. Now get your ass out there and make my money.
Dull, that's real. And I'm going to tell you something too, man, because this is something where when we look at how a lot of these labels, because we've seen over the past almost 20 years now where there has been a resurgence. Well, hip-hop has always been about doing it by DIY aesthetic. And as we saw labels like Koch, Landspeed, you know, as they started in the late 90s, early 2000s, that's where you saw a lot of rappers who were going to these independent labels where the trick was they don't pay. You are totally 100% responsible for your promotions in terms of your getting your ad placements, because we didn't even talk about ad placements in magazines that these labels were doing. But what it is if your record sells well on these independent labels, you can make like $6-7 on it, you know. So that's what Core Mega did after he left Def Jam Records, after that fiasco went down and he left Def Jam after he was, you know, kicked out of the firm. We all know that story. And he went to Landspeed Records. It was owned by Bob Perry. And this is how cold the game is, and you probably know this as well, Con. Me and King talked about it. So what happened was with Mega, when Mega did the original Testament album in 1997, it wasn't released because of obviously the issues he had internally with the firm. This, of course, and on Off the Cuff Radio, we try our best in journalistic credibility to report it as accurately as possible. And either one of you correct me if I get it fucked up along the story. But what happened was because Cormega didn't want to sign with Steve Stout, you know, who I believe was who was managing Nas and the firm at the time, Mega did not want Steve Stout to manage him, and that caused a rift. And that's why eventually he was kicked out of the group. So he had already recorded the album for Def Jam, and the Testament was never released. So 4 years later, he goes to Landspeed Records. He drops The Realness, and he does it independently. It does very well. I think it sold like 200,000 copies. And, of course, he gets his $7-8 off of it, so he's doing well, and then releases Legal Hustle the next year in 2002. Now, all the while, and he spoke on this in XXL, he spoke about what was going on with the original Testament album, that he was saying – that, you know, they were trying to, he wanted to buy the rights to the original album, and they were still trying to charge him, I believe, like $250,000. Now, if you ask an entertainment lawyer in the industry, if the album depreciates because of the age, regardless of how dope the music is, and it took Mega damn near, because he ended up getting the rights for Testament back in late 2003, and he released it in 2004. So you figure this is 7 years from when he initially had recorded it. And even then, because I have the original Testament album, but when I listen to the one I bought in the store in the original, there's still a lot of stuff that's left off of the new one, which tells you how much there was probably still some clearances and stuff that had to be taken care of, which probably were not resolved. But I'm like, right. Yo, this is crazy. Yeah, it's crazy. Yeah.
So these artists now –
yeah.
are getting smarter, and they're realizing, like an artist like Chance the Rapper, he's gotten Grammys, and he's not even signed to a label. But what they don't tell you is he's signed to Apple. He has a contract with Apple. So it's not even about this old model of a record label, and I used to try to tell artists this, you have to think of a record label as a bank.
Right.
I make the rhyme. My partner makes the beat. We have a finished product. We take it to the label and give it to them and say, give us back 10, 15 cents for every one you sell. And y'all can keep the original. That's essentially what we're doing. But 5 years from today, the music industry as we know it, it has already imploded. But they're just staying several steps ahead of us because we're not educating ourselves on how the music business works and how the business model is structured. And you have the ability and the right to structure it how you see fit, as long as you're not begging to be on one of these 1,200 clear channel radio stations or somebody who's controlling the airwaves. The internet has, in fact, leveled the playing field.
Yes, it has.
Where you,
because they can,
you can create right, your own movement and your own financial base and your fan base and your super fan base of those that specifically report to you, and you have a direct-to-consumer relationship without a middleman called the record label.
You know, and it's, and that's real talk, Con, because what it is, and there's always, and I'm one, and I'm, and I, and I'm gladly falls into that joke. They always say that the there's a saying. It's not even a joke. They say that the real hip hop heads don't listen to the radio. They read the they read the internet blogs, and they read the magazines. And King and myself, Sam and Chinchilla, that's how we find out about the new acts. You know, in terms of how we get guests for the show, you know, we've been blessed to have so many legends and independents alike. You know, and we. I'll just go on IG and I'll just, you know, go through and just listen to artists and just, they're dope. I tell one thing about it, and I will tell our, any artists out there, somebody's going to listen to you if you're hot. You don't need a label to validate your greatness. If you're dope, hey, somebody's going to hear you.
That's right.
You know, we're going to, you know, us, our operation, you know, con anybody, we're going to hear you. We're going to support you. We're going to get you on the best way we can if we, you know, and so many others will. But what's happened now is that you still have so many artists that are still trying to chase this dream of getting on a label. But as you said, Con, a lot of these labels, it's not good. I tell any artist to measure, because you look, there's one artist who's a legend, and I'm a stan of his, E-40. I can't think. I mean, the man has been with Jive Records for about 30 years, and him and Jive have a straight distribution, you know, have a straight distribution deal. E-40 does the albums. Jive gets paid their distribution fee. E gets his money. And, I mean,
you gotta do it.
E is like, oh, my God.
And, you know, he was revolutionary because he was the first one to secure a record deal in that way, especially as a hip hop artist. He got $3.5 million way back in the day. But
I didn't know
he
that.
Has the leverage of, yeah, you can research him when he signed a $3.5 million deal with Jive Records.
Right.
To where he was still in control of his product. And
yeah,
that is the same way that Master P studied for, and got,
yeah,
that,
he got
that gain from the Bay Area.
Yeah, because he was out there in Richmond, California under the tutelage of Uncle St. Charles when he opened up the record store in Richmond, California. Yes, and he brought it back when he signed with Priority, when he got his major label deal. I believe that was in 1994, 95. He had a 85-15 deal where they would get 15% distribution, and then he would get 85% of profits, which also in late 1997, Cash Money was signed with Universal Records, where they would get the $30 million up front.
And see, that's what I'm saying. Now you have the offspring of Master P, the offspring of Cash Money, the offspring of E-40, who studied their blueprints and how they did it, and they're getting smarter and wiser, which brings us full circle to my original point about the state of hip-hop music as we know it right now.
Let's get to it.
So the labels and these corporate killers, these demonic, smart, crooked deceivers, they're seeing in this era of everybody wanting to be known, which is why selfies are so important, and studies have shown that social media leads to depression.
Dog, but yo, so, yo, yo. I I studied, but when I, in my class, we talked about this, about how you can tell people's mental and are they predisposed to arrogance and conceit because they always have to have pictures of themselves out there.
Yeah.
And when you become hooked on seeing yourself,
right.
See, in our era, there was no such thing as a selfie. That
right.
shows how people are consumed with themselves. And you get a couple of likes, you get a couple of emojis and a few hearts. Oh, man, your whole life is turned around because 15 people like the post that you put up. So now the satanic crooked deceiver comes along and he says, well, I can make you bigger. Because I control these sites. I control
right.
how many people can even see your selfie that you put up. All you got to do is pay Facebook for the ad campaign, and then they can expose you to more people. And we have become drunk off of the selfies. And so the labels, everybody's so ego-starved that the women would just be butt-ass naked, and the guys will do whatever, like the song with Cardi B and Offset says, you do anything for clout. So we in that era now where visibility is the new crack. It's the new
Tell
dope
it.
On the street. The new dope on the street is likes and views. It's not even the physical drug, but we use the likes and the views to usher in this new level of drug rap. I got a song coming out called Drug Rap in the near future that's talking about this whole thing where this has become a culture now, where in our era, the culture was to sell the drug. Now the era is to do the drug.
And before we get to that, because I definitely want to get your thoughts on that, Khan, you know, it's crazy because, you know, everybody back in the day, you know, it was like the biggest thing to be on television, you know, it was the biggest thing to be known. You know, back in the day, man, you know, I mean, we didn't know, obviously, the technology would advance itself in the capacity that it did in reference to, I mean, doll. I mean, if you had a pager back then, if you want to, you know, if you want to give that impression of being on the block. I mean, a pager is one thing. If you had two, you was big time. If you had a cell phone, you were doing it. And now, I mean, can you imagine what it would have been like 20 years ago if camera phones had been around? I mean,
and that's
now,
the way that this has changed.
Yeah,
we are so attention starved.
Right.
The way if we get 13 people to comment and say that we trash, we going to have a bad day. We not going to want to come outside because 13 people called our material, our content trash. Or you can be whoever you want to be on the internet with behind a keyboard or a keypad on your phone. You could be balling out of control. Instagram models, they can be everything. But you follow them at home and you see what the real deal is. It's like the Wizard of Oz. Behind this curtain, he had all these sound effects and the Oz has spoken. But when you move that curtain back, you see it's just this little dude talking on a microphone. And you don't realize you had the power to do that all along yourself.
And it's crazy, man, because what you're dealing with is a situation where people, one thing about it is you know, social media is beautiful on one thing because that's allowed people to come together in ways because social media has benefited us so much. But it's like anything. It's like a loaded gun if you don't know how to use it. And you have some people, they become so consumed with the idea of being known that they don't live like you said. You know, they forget who they are. My thing, you know, we have a saying, we know who you are in real life. You know, but you got people that will go out there and try to give this impression of it like they got, you know, they pose on a Bentley and we know it's not theirs, or they flash their money around tax time, or a chick is posing talking about she all that. I'm like, yeah, but we know you fuck niggas for money too. You know, it's like.
Hey, look, if you walk up, I challenge any artist listening to this podcast, go up to somebody that is 16 years old or under and tell them you got some music out. They're going to ask you, is it on YouTube? Then they're going to ask you how many views you got.
Right.
So views in their eyes create value. Not understanding and realizing for the right amount of money, you could buy views. You could buy reviews. Everything is for sale. So you're not really what you portray yourself to be, and this is why the playing field is leveled for an artist like Kendrick Lamar or J. Cole or what is his name? Lecrae. The gospel.
Yeah, because
artist.
they have an organic audience that just gravitated to their music and they didn't have to do anything.
Exactly. Right. In a world where you could be anything, you should just try being yourself.
And you know,
Don,
go ahead.
Or as Tupac would say, keeping it real. That's
and
what
we got
Tupac
a little bit of,
was about.
Yeah, and we got a little bit of time left, but I definitely want to expound on that too, because like you said, a lot of people think that Kendrick started off at on the top of things, but a lot of people don't know about, see, everybody sees once you reach where you're trying to get, but they don't know the grind that it takes to get there. Kendrick, actually, his first mixtape was called Youngest Head Nigga in Charge, and that was released back in, I believe, 2008 when he was still in high school, maybe 2004. He was a younger nigga when he did it, you know what I'm saying? But it's like, you know, but that was like, you can't even find that now because it was strictly in Compton where he was in high school. Then his album Section 80 came out, I believe, in 2010, 2011. And it was, the critics loved it, you know, but it just wasn't heavy out there. When he signed with Dre, that's when he dropped Good Kid, Mad City, and that's when it really took
boost.
Off for him. Yeah. But Kendrick is already
– boost.
Yeah,
and that is what we misunderstand as artists. See that
right.
Next level. I'll give you one of the clearest examples of an independent on two different levels who has this understanding that you don't need what you think you need if you have a clear vision of where you want to go. Look at Tech N9ne.
Mm-hmm.
Tech N9ne.
Shout out
Strange
to Strange Music.
Yes. Tech N9ne and Strange Music has the largest or most successful independent rap label in the world.
In Kansas City, they have a full warehouse of recording studio, press up plant, merchandising store. Everything is right there. Yes, I have a XXL issue from like, I think, 10 years ago where they profiled them. That operation they
Look,
got is
they
insane.
Got car, they got their own car wash. They got, I mean, I was on the phone with Travis O'Gwen and Snoop Dogg when I was on security with them. We were trying to get Tech N9ne and Snoop to go on tour together. And Travis O'Gwen was on that phone telling us they might get $10,000 to do a show on any given night. But in that same night, they're going to do $50,000. They did $55,000
in merchandising.
In merchandising and $10,000 for the show. If you go on Strange Music's website right now, they got over 500 products. Every possible thing you can think of that they can put their logo or Tech N9ne's name on it to sell, because they built their following from the ground up. And when the major labels came to them and said, we want to do a deal with y'all for $60 million, it did not take Tech and Travis 2 minutes to tell them no thank you.
Because the thing is, it's like this. When you have your own, even if it's slow money, when their money is anything but slow, but when you have that money that's steady where you know your base is there, you're not pressed about it because you know you're going to make it regardless. Whether it's slow or fast, it's going to come. And you don't need that money from another label with all the strings attached to it, because there are beautiful people in the world that will help you, but a lot of people are not that altruistic to just give you $60 million and they don't want something back from it.
$60 million,
hey,
not no chump change either.
It's the right, and they turned it down. It didn't even take them 2 minutes to make that decision because they did the math and they did the numbers. And
in terms of what they make in a year.
What they make in a year.
It goes here with the poverty mindset because I think with a lot of guys coming into the game, they probably just took that money and be like, look, that's $60 million. But see, when you have that leverage, you have that time to pretty much decipher the mathematics and see how this deal really looking. Like, are we really getting $60 million or are they getting,
exactly,
how much cut are they getting?
Exactly.
Look,
exactly.
I say it's the classic story of the two bulls, the baby bull, the young bull and the old bull on the top of the hill looking down at all these cows. And the young bull says, why don't we run down this hill and screw one of them cows? and the OG bull, the triple OG bull says, no. Why don't we walk down this hill and screw all of the cows?
That's real, though.
You want to run down to get one, not realizing when you run down there, the rest of them are going to scatter. And you might get one, but if you take your time, walk down the hill, you won't startle the cows. They'll sit there, and you can just run through them how you want to run through them.
That's
the
game right there.
The mindset. That was free game. Yeah, I ain't got to pay for that. But that's the way that we need to see our art as intellectual property that we are in control of and we dictate. Look how Beyonce dropped an album with no promotion. You just look up and an album
came
out.
She did it twice. Dude,
twice.
She did it twice.
Twice. You didn't need a record. All you had to do was tweet it. New album available at midnight. And everybody goes crazy.
If that, when she dropped the Beyonce album back in 2003, and it was around 2013 rather, 2013, it was around this time, and because she dropped it online out of nowhere, and then like 2-3 weeks later, the physicals came out because I got the physical. I mean, and then a couple years later, when she did the Lemonade album, she did the whole video presentation on HBO, and then of course, come Monday, we done found out that she just dropped the album out of nowhere. And it's like, yo, I'm like.
But that's my point. See, we not understanding the power that we have. So if you got 10,000 followers on social media, and if you get 1,000 of those 10,000 to support your effort, look, you're going to make more money from 1,000 of your 10,000 followers than you would signing with a record label.
That's true. Now, this, before I forget, I definitely want to ask you, because we're definitely going to have you back on, but we want to touch as much as we could. I wanted to ask you when you were talking about the change up in terms of the drug dealer music versus the drug user music. We have to first, of course, give our condolences to Juice WRLD. And I mean, if that's not a wake up call about what that industry can do to you when you get in the excess of it. King and myself wanted to get your thoughts on this, Con. Where did the transition come in terms of where it shifted to where the drug use became so prevalent in the industry where weed back in the day was the hardest thing anybody ever did, but now we got pills, we got coke, we got heroin,
okay. We
got, yeah, all of that. Where did it change?
They introduced it. There's a video on YouTube where it talks about how you can kill a frog, right? And you put this frog in a pot of water.
Mm-hmm.
They said the interesting thing about a frog is it adjusts its body to the room temperature. A frog likes to be comfortable. So if you take a frog and hang it over a pot of boiling water, that frog is going to try to jump out of your hand. But if you sit that same frog in that pot of water and gradually raise the temperature of that water, the frog will not move, and you can literally boil the frog because the frog continues to adjust its body temperature to the temperature of the water in the pot, not realizing it's being boiled.
Mm.
That's how they have done us with this music, because at first, conscious music was popping. If you remember, Self-Destruction, KRS-One, Public Enemy, Lakim Shabazz, Queen Latifah,
yeah.
X-Clan, you name it, and it was rolling. So that consciousness was the mainstream, not because they were interested in conscious music. They were interested in money. What is selling? And then somebody got the bright idea that we are going, they started to see, oh, if we keep this conscious music going, it's going to revolutionize the entire game. So these people are waking up. So we can't have them to wake up. We got to put them back to sleep. And as much as I love NWA and I'm thankful for Ice Cube, Dre, MC Ren, DJ Yella, Eazy-E, the DOC, Snoop D-O-double-G, just think for a minute. If you take NWA out of the game and you look at all of the offspring that came from NWA, rap music would not even be what we know right now. You would have
it
to,
wouldn't.
You took NWA out, that means you have to take Eminem out, you have to take Tupac out, you have to take Bone Thugs and Harmony out, you have to take Lil Bow Wow out, you have to take West Side Connection out, and the list just goes on and on and on. Kendrick Lamar, you got to take
him
out.
Dogg Pound,
you
got
to take
him out too.
Lady of Rage, you got to take out. The Game,
you
got to
take him out too.
Mac 10 got to go. Even Red Man on the East Coast got to go. It's so many from NWA. But see, what NWA did, they ushered in a new level of lowness. Not because that's what they wanted to do, but those behind them knew that it would change the trajectory of where we were headed with all this fight the power rap and self-destruction rap. So they introduced niggas with attitude. Now, we thought we was getting away from being niggas. They said, no, we're going to make niggas with attitudes the baddest group out. So, NWA, bitches with problems, hoes with attitudes. So, all that begins to degrade and demoralize us to a hot beat, to a hot chorus. But it's getting progressively raunchier, too short, cocktails. All of this stuff is coming out, and it is getting worse and worse and worse. So there's a new level, a new standard of low, ratchetness. That sets the stage for the city girls and the trap girls. And then you throw in a 3-6 mafia. 3-6 mafia, 666. So you're just introducing this party, dance, drug atmosphere, right? And an artist like Juice WRLD, they interviewed him. He said when he was in the sixth grade, he was looking up to artists like 3-6 Mafia in the sixth grade. And everybody was talking about popping or sipping lean and doing this and the syrup moving and all of that. And that inspired him and sparked his curiosity as a sixth grade.
You know, Khan, it's crazy because when we look at the trajectory of where gangster rap was, it was speaking on another level of the street life that I think had not been brought. But as you said earlier about how it could be monetized, you know, for the contribution.
I mean to cut you off to you, Matt, but.
Oh, go ahead.
When labels start, it's like, it's just like Khan said, it's like the artists, they don't have their intention to put out music to where it could pretty much lure people to the wrong path. It's just that when you give these people in higher positions that power, they basically strip it to where they monetize everything. Just like even when you have the Niggas for Life album, which was possibly sonically one of the greatest albums I've heard. But
content-wise,
that shit was crazy.
Yeah,
they on there raping. They raping women in cars, and everybody watching. I'm just saying. See, it produced a new level of low, just like the frog sitting in the water. We as the consumer not realizing that they are boiling us in a pot of water to the whole world. When I was on the road with Snoop, and we went over to the UK, there were black people that did not speak English. And their only way of learning English was from watching rap videos on BET Uncut and MTV hip hop shows. That's where they learned black English from. And they would walk up to me with my suit on. They say, "Oh, I know English, my nigga. What's up, motherfucker?" That's how they would talk because they learned it from the rap video. And they look at the rap videos and they say, "Well, this is how we really are." And white people look at the rap videos and say, "This is how we really are." So they put us in this animal category. So now it's no coincidence that now we savage. Everything we talking about savage and ratchet, and Megan Thee Stallion is the new standard. Trap girls is the city girls is the new standard. You know what I'm saying? So the young girls, the 8-year-olds, the 10-year-olds now are looking up to Cardi B, Megan Thee Stallion. No disrespect to none of them. I think that artistically they have talent, but content wise, you're not looking at the man by. Can you imagine an album coming out called Spicks for Life or Kike Life?
The Mexicans and Jews be looking at them.
The Jews ain't even gonna let an album come out called Kike Life.
Oh, hell no.
No.
No way.
They are not going to promote themselves in that bestial, savage light. So in the movie,
even when the
Straight
Beastie Boys came out, even when the Beastie Boys came out and they were Jewish, you know, they were not doing anything crazy. They weren't, you know, saying nothing crazy like that against their own people.
Look, when Ice Cube, if you go back in the movie Straight Outta Compton, when Jerry Heller heard Ice Cube's lyrics on Death Certificate, when he said, "Cause you let a Jew break up my crew," when Jerry Heller heard that in the movie, Jerry Heller went off and said, "Can you believe this son of a bitch? We need to protest. We need to get the ADL out on him. That cocksucker, he is talking about Jew. This is anti-Semitic. We need to riot against." But this same Jerry Heller did not have a problem with us saying, "Don't matter, just don't bite it." It's the world's biggest. All that was fine. Here's a little something about a nigga like me. All that was cool with Jerry Heller. But the minute he said Jew in his lyrics, the radar turned on. When Kanye West made remarks about how the Jewish people control the fashion industry, they called Kanye West anti-Semitic. And once they label you that, man, you might as well hang it up because they are the ones with the real money. And this is not anti-Semitic. This is called fight these facts. Follow the money. Hashtag follow the money. And you will see where the money leads you to. The same. It's not a coincidence. They just had congressional hearings where they were grilling Al Sharpton about, "Did you say this about Jews? Did you say this about Jews? Did you say that about Jews?" In this whole Donald Trump, impeach Donald Trump era, look at how they handle us versus how they handle one another. And that, I ain't got no problem with a Jewish person. I treat an individual based on their character and how they are with me. But as long as you don't cross the line, it doesn't matter what, because it's not about color. It's about, are you going to be principled and practice justice and deal with me in an equitable way that is beneficial to me? If not, I got to deal with you with a long handle spoon, because historically, I can't change the stripes on a tiger and I can't change the leopard spots. So I got to know that I'm walking up to a leopard and I'm walking up to a tiger. So I can't deal with the tiger like it's a teddy bear.
Oh, no. And that's something where, you know, when we look at that situation, you know, it's just something where it's business at the end in terms of what goes on. You know, in that movie, when Jerry got so upset, basically it wasn't about the fact of Q, because, I mean, you know, of course, it was a movie, but when you look at it, you know, his character was upset because of the fact that Cube called it out for what it was. That basically y'all let somebody, you know, the Jew, you know, when he said the Jewish part, that was the religious qualifier, but the fact is, yeah, y'all let someone break up the crew, and that's what it was.
You know what's crazy, too, is if you really listen to the death certificate on some of these streaming sites, they got certain versions of that song where they edited you out, or no Vaseline.
Look, I'm going to tell y'all and y'all listeners, if you haven't heard of it, it is a guy called White Mike on YouTube. He spoke for 20 minutes, and he broke down how this is intentional, the criminalization of the black male in today's society and the degradation of rap music and having us to assault one another, where that is okay as long as it doesn't spill over into their music, into their world. They want to live vicariously through us, and we represent the underworld. That's why Tupac, Brenda Got a Baby Tupac, and the Keep Your Head Up Tupac, and Soldier Story Tupac is much different than You Wonder Why They Call You Bitch Tupac, or Ain't Nothing But a Gangsta Party Tupac.
Go ahead, King.
Yeah, and I was going to ask you this, too, because somebody shot this question to me about that Tupac and Khalid Muhammad speech that you did security for. Now, do you think that, considering the fact that they have released so much material on Tupac for the past 23, 24 years, do you think that Interscope purposely had that hidden?
Obviously, if they took an excerpt from that speech, don't you think they saw the whole speech? If they saw the whole speech and decided to put that one excerpt in there, they know why they could not show more of that entire speech, because it would spark and change the mind and the viewpoint of today's youth who admire and look up to Tupac, and it would open up a new way of thinking. So they say, no, we're not going to keep that version of Tupac out before the world. We're going to keep the troublesome, erratic acting, wilding out thug Tupac in front of the world, because that serves our purpose better and leads the young people further down a rabbit hole. But he was 22 in that video, dropping all that game at 22, and he meant what he said. And they definitely didn't want you to see Dr. Khalid sitting up there on the panel or hearing what Dr. Khalid had to say after Tupac, because if you thought what Tupac said was revolutionary, when Dr. Khalid got up there, he made it like Tupac didn't even touch the podium. That's how hard Dr. Khalid came.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Look, for those that don't know about Dr. Khalid Muhammad, man, I'm like, yo, he would bring that smoke like it won't nothing.
And it was interesting, I was telling T-Max about this. I had went to one of his lectures, and I met him a year before he died. And let me just be the first to say, it's not for the weak at heart. If you can't digest the truth, you might as well don't even click on one of his videos.
Yeah.
And then, look, Dr. Khalid was not playing. It was when Dr. Khalid went to Kennedy King College and started with the subject, the secret relationship between blacks and Jews, they went to work on him. And they said, oh, no, you can't say nothing about no Jews.
Now,
and it's not
now
just about Jewish people, because if I call you childish, I'm not calling you a real child. I'm saying you're acting like one. So if I call you Jewish, you kind of Jew, but you really not a Jew. And that's what Dr. Khalid was dealing with. And Tupac was coming into the reality of these things. Even the Jewish lady, when he went to the School of the Arts, it was a Jewish lady that was helping Tupac to bring out his brilliance as a young man. But he was conflicted because he saw the condition of his people and how
right.
we were always on the bottom rail, and that disturbed him. And ultimately, when his mother was cracked out and suffered, and she was on the front line trying to fight for black people, and to see black people just leave her and abandon her and not even come by her side, like he said in that speech that his mother told him, boy, don't you know they just gonna kill your black ass and that's just gonna be it. And 3 years later, he was dead.
Yeah. There was also another question I wanted to ask you, too, and I know this is somewhat of a sensitive subject, because the King College speech that Dr. Muhammad gave was, if you know, especially from the hip-hop and not only black, you know, black history pantheon, was one of the most infamous and incendiary. How did that relationship affect him with Farrakhan after that? Because a lot of people look at that situation, that was, they said that was where the beginning of the strain between him and Minister Farrakhan.
Well, and you know what? I was blessed. The my mentor, five-star General James, also known as Brother Aziz Muhammad, he was directly trained as a soldier by Dr. Khalid. And his relationship mm-hmm. with Dr. Khalid is like Minister Farrakhan's relationship was with Malcolm X. So
yes,
there were times and opportunities that we went on tour, myself and the five-star general, where we would be the opening act before Brother Khalid would give his speech, or he would introduce us himself after he spoke. And we would we were on the Donahue show with him as his security. We lived with him in his penthouse in New Jersey for about a week or so, that week that he went on the Donahue show in 94. But it began to strain him and the minister's relationship, not because he said what he said and the minister had to publicly discipline him, so to speak, because of how he spoke. The minister said he was trying to make Brother Khalid into a statesman. He said, and when you're on the road to becoming a statesman, you can't talk on the top of the hill the same way you do in the basement, or you're going to lose people as you ascend and go to higher levels. You don't have to compromise the truth that you speak, but you do have to be conscious of the language that you use and the manner in which you deliver it, because you're affecting more and more people, and God is raising you to a level to where your truth that comes out of your mouth has a more universal appeal to it without alienating any one particular group. Brother Khalid, he just wasn't cut from that cloth. He was just one of those, what he would describe himself, he's just a good old field nigga. Hey, man, just leave me out here where it's grimy, where is rough, and where the buildings are shot up, and the alcoholics are sitting in the abandoned, the bandos and on the corner. That's where I'm more comfortable. But when you start raising me up to be on a national platform, now I have to switch up how I talk to appease what looks like to appease people. I ain't with all that, so I'm not finna be doing all of that. And then you had the agent provocateurs. I know for a fact, because I saw how people were trying to influence Brother Khalid. They were saying, man, you a leader within your own right, man. You don't need Farrakhan to be showing you nothing. The people look up to you, not realizing that he was walking in the same footsteps that Malcolm X walked in when Malcolm X made the ill-timed remarks when President Kennedy had
chickens
gotten
come
killed.
Home to roost. The chickens come
See,
home to roost.
It was a true statement that Malcolm made, but it was truth spoken out of season that ill affected all those Muslim brothers that were locked up in prison. He made life harder on them because they it was black people that loved Kennedy. And so when he made that statement after being advised by his teacher, don't make no comment, that began to undo all the good work that Malcolm had done. It didn't change the truth of what he said, but the manner in which he said it, the timing was bad. So imagine if Dr. Khalid was alive right now, speaking in the way that we know him to have spoke back in the day. He couldn't even stand in today's time saying one-third of what he was known for saying. Even though it's true what he said, they wouldn't let him get away with that.
And this is going back over 20.
Everybody gets outraged and offended over anything. I mean, especially on Twitter.
Man,
he'd be lighting black Twitter up every day.
If you offended by what people are saying now, you might jump off a bridge hearing what Dr. Khalid is saying. And let me tell you, I got pictures of Dr. Khalid on my wall in my house right now. Because that man was a warrior. He was committed, and he gave his life to that struggle. And that's why one of the bars that I have, the first line I say, I got the spirit of Khalid, blood of Nat Turner, Farrakhan's mind, UEP's Black Burner, skills of Paul Robeson and the Last Poet, Shaka Zulu's path, but I'm going fast forward. The strategies of Hannibal when they mix with Pac. I am what the fiends want when they hitting the block. I'm swinging low when the chariot's coming. I'm the black male version of Harriet Tubman. Ain't nothing but a G thing. Guerrilla warfare. Gangsters listening. Got them even more scared. Voice of the youth spitting truth in the booth. Ignorance got them tied up, but I'ma cut them loose. Give them juice like Tropicana so they can hit the nail on the head with a lot of hammers. Raw grammar. Smoking these bomb beats. I am the rose that grows from the concrete. Gotta deliver these coons and these clown niggas. Do you realize how stupid you sound, nigga? What kind of legacy you leaving behind? This is more than just a beat and a rhyme. This is uncontrolled substance.
And I mean, that's...
Come on, man.
Man, ooh.
I just dropped so much in there, but I learned how to be more universal in what I say, in the way that I say it, without compromising the truth and the content of what I say. There's a line I got on a song we just did called Act Like You Understand. One of the lines I said was, did you know that a club ain't nothing but a liquor store with some music in it? I'm just telling the truth when I do what I do, so tell me why you offended. A club is a liquor store with some music in it.
Yeah,
that's,
and I mean, when you break down the fundamentals.
That's a double-layered meaning right there.
But see, just a simple line like that is a thought-provoking line. It's something to make you go, I never thought about that. You know what? Damn, that is true. And so you just have to be strategic in the way that you go about it while you're casting your net out here in this sea of sin to retrieve our people, because you're going against an enemy that's working hard to keep them down, wallowing in that. So while we busy talking about act up, you can get snatched up, a real-ass bitch give a fuck about a nigga, they're busy controlling the monetization of everything, while we're busy just showing our ass like Lizzo at a Laker game. And that ain't no disrespect to Lizzo. I like Lizzo. I think she's talented, but I think that she's being used by forces that are bigger than herself. You will never see a Jewish woman doing that.
And I rock with Lizzo too. I just thought from a perspective of it, it's like, I understand her hustle and her grind of how long it took her to get to where she is, and I love her confidence and self-assuredness, but like you said, there's an appropriate time and place for whatever you do, and I just didn't think that was something that was appropriate. You know, I just didn't think, I'm like, yo, it's like, we get it that you're a celebrity, but you don't have to keep doing things to show everybody how much of a free spirit you are. It is okay to just be regular sometimes. I mean, she just dropped a little mark. Go ahead. Oh, she was saying the other day how she was thinking about. Yeah, go ahead. Well, no, go ahead. You'll say it and I'll say it. Go ahead.
This is why, irregardless of what we think Barack Obama did or didn't do while he was in office, I really salute that man on how he represented on a national and international and world view. He and his family.
Yes,
they represented black. They represented black excellence in that White House. Even if they didn't come up with policies and all that to help advance black people and put us in a position to win, the mere fact that they represented in that White House the way that they did and was scandal-free while they were
for
in
8 years. 8 years.
For 8 years.
No problem.
Man, that showed the possibility. That knocked the roof off of what we could do as black people in a civilized. You never seen Michelle Obama out of pocket. You never seen her smoking a cigarette at a mic stand. You never seen her with a mini skirt on. Even if she liked to wear one in private, she knows and knew that it's a time and a place to represent your excellence. And, man, I salute them, regardless of if I agree with every political move that Barack Obama did or didn't do. That's not my issue at this point or my argument. I'm just saying how they represented us. There's no black person that couldn't look at them and say, man, they held it down.
And they wanted to roast him because he wore a tan suit. I'm like, the man wanted to wear a tan suit. Let him wear a tan suit. I'm like, look what we got in the office now, but that's a different story. Now, but
come
the thing
on, man.
With Lizzo,
you got
like,
Captain Cheeto, Kester Cheeto in the office right now.
Mr. Grab him by the pussy himself. But it's like, I said it. But it's like with Lizzo. Lizzo said made a remark talking about how she wants to do a new performance. I'm slapping my head upside like Star Trek with Rikers and Picard, and I'm doing a double face palm at the same damn time, and I'm like, this girl just, I'm like, she wants to do a new performance. I'm like, okay, do you really need to put that out there?
Hey, when you got a circus, don't you want to go see something bizarre? What will be more bizarre than a heavyweight naked black woman singing?
She got 9 Grammy nods out of there and a Time magazine cover. They
and guess what? She's only
going to
be. So the next. So if Lizzo is at that level, then who's going to be coming behind Lizzo and what will they have to do? Because she raised the bar on ratchetness. So the next one is looking up to that. And they're saying, yeah, I want to show my ass too. Well, if she want to perform naked, I want to do this naked or I want to do that. And so they strategically have us look up to those that set the standard of nothingness, all while we complaining about respect me. And I told my queen this. I said, you know, I got a secret. I got a little thing for reality shows. I like to watch them. But when I watch them from a different perspective and I look at our women on these shows, you know, they had a show called Beyond the Pole that is just talking about strippers.
Strippers, right,
so
right.
They had your Afrocentric stripper. They had your intelligent stripper. They had your entrepreneur stripper, but they were all strippers. Then
right.
You got the other show, Married to Medicine. You got all these doctors married to other doctors. But the level of ratchetness of these women, even though they're doctors, with degrees and practicing, they're all ratchet, ready to fight, low down, backstabbing and conniving. If you want to go to Love and Hip Hop, same thing. If you want to go to Black Ink Crew, same thing. If you want to go with when they used to have Bad Girls Club on, same thing. But they never show their own people with this degree of debauchery. And so when Tupac was talking about keep your head up, you can't keep your head up now. What you going to keep your head up about?
And that's something, Khan, that I've always had a problem with these reality shows, especially with the plight of the black man, black woman, and black child in America with all these negative perceptions and everything of us. And I'm like, because it shows, like you said, it lowers the common denominator of standard and substance, because it shows a lot of times
even if some of that stuff is quote unquote scripted, it still shows, it gives a bad impression of what we will do to get ourselves out there to be famous. And we will go on national TV and we will play to these negative stereotypes, misconceptions, and pre-notions that everybody has, that we, that, you know, black men walk around, have a whole bunch of kids and don't take care of them. All black women want is just to be with, you know, dudes that got money. You know, it's a whole bunch of backbiting and dysfunction, and that's not who we are. We are a race of survivors. We are a race of achievers, of inventors, innovators, and intellectuals.
See, all of that means nothing if I can be on a video with a Bentley and some strippers making their ass clap, and I'm throwing money in the air. See, so the imagery of what success looks like to us is what we see in a music video. We're not looking at black inventors. We're not looking at the struggle of Harriet Tubman. That's a slave movie. But where's the 2019 Harriet Tubman at? Where's she at on the movie screen?
Right.
They're not going to put no. Where's the black superhero that will conquer all the enemies? I remember when Will Smith played Hancock. He was a superhero, but he was drunk.
Yeah.
And so this is the dynamic that we're always up against. And Satan is so wise and crooked in how he approaches us. But with this music, man, it has us hook, line, and sinker. So did you know that YouTube deleted my channel shortly after we had that Tupac video up? And I had to appeal it and said that nothing on my channel violates the terms of service for YouTube. And I demand that y'all restore my channel immediately. And they put that channel back up in less than 12 hours.
Hey, nobody
that's
likes
crazy,
a lawsuit.
Man, it shows you right there. That's how we connected, man, because I did a video, because as soon as I seen you post it, I was like, wow. Because I've been looking for this interview, honestly, in its entirety for like almost 20-something years, and I found it odd.
But that's what I've been hearing. I've been hearing it from everybody.
Yes, and I just found it very odd that considering all the stories, all the content, interviews, movies, documentaries, nobody has put this out on Tupac, and I want to know why. And we connected on that basis alone because you hit me up, and you was like, yeah, go ahead and check the channel out. And we got the whole thing in its entirety. I was like, man, finally. That was like a wild
and
goose
I didn't
getting
look.
That, getting
and
that
you,
footage.
And when I put it up, I had no idea that it wasn't even online anywhere. I didn't know that nobody had seen this footage. I just put it up because it was dear to me. I thought that people would enjoy it, but I didn't know I was the first one to put it up.
You are,
that's
brother.
Like, yeah, you are. And that was like a urban legend because we heard about it for so many years. But, of course, this is pre-social media. This is pre-cell phone video. So it's like, you know, we had an idea it existed, but it's like, yo, you know, what if we actually had the chance to see it? And you blessed us with it. Thank you.
Now, just imagine, if he talked like that for those 18 minutes on that video, how much more footage is it of him talking in other places during that same time period where he spoke like that? That they're making sure don't see the light of day, because they know that if you feed on that Tupac, all you do is go look through the comments, even on your page. If you posted a snippet or you go on my, look at the comments. It's showing that the people have an outcry and they're pouring out their heart, saying we need somebody like this today. If Tupac was here, the music wouldn't be like this. If this Tupac was present, this wouldn't be that way.
We all say the same thing. If Big and Pop were alive today, how would hip-hop be different?
And so that's just the thing. Remember, Tupac died in 96, Biggie died in 97. So just think,
6 months
we are now, we're 23 and 24 years up from those two giants' death. So that means that a 25-year-old person today was 1 and 2 years old when Biggie and Pac were at their height.
Yeah.
They don't, so a whole generation has been deprived of the realness of just these two individuals.
Yeah.
So I'm able to tell the age of somebody by what music they listen to. I say, okay, well, you was born in 2000. So what was banging for you when you was 15? Exactly. So I'm able to place them in different eras. But what I like most about what I do uniquely, because I do mentoring, I work in the school system in Chicago and out here in Gary, Indiana, with a group called Hip Hop Detox, where we've serviced over 300,000 youth in a 10 or 11 year time span. What I like about it is that I still can make music that is attractive to a 12-year-old, a 15-year-old, a 20-year-old, a 30-year-old, a 40-year-old, a 50-year-old, and a 60-year-old. I know how to uniquely do it to where it has that broad appeal. I don't sound I'm rapping back in the 90s. I just won a $1,000 rap contest back on Halloween. That video I posted on my channel, where I beat about 40 different rappers, and I'm up there with a suit and tie on, killing them, literally.
Look, if you can do it in Gary, if you in Gary, Indiana, for those people that think Gary, Indiana is just about where the Jacksons came from, I'm like, Gary is serious.
Come on, man.
Gary
but
is
you
real.
You got raw talent in every community, in every city. Wherever we at, you got genius wherever we are. But we don't utilize our own genius, and that's how we allow ourselves to be exploited, raped, robbed, and pillaged, and taken complete advantage of by outside opposing forces who don't have our best interests at heart. They didn't love Tupac no more than they love Malcolm. They didn't love Dr. King. They didn't love Harriet Tubman. They put that movie out and got behind it because it made money. And
right.
At the end of the day, they can rewrite Harriet Tubman's history. But even in the watered-down version of Harriet, some little young black girl is going to look at that and aspire to want to be like that.
I'm really hoping that that article they said, and I don't know how true it was. I don't know if somebody was just trying to be funny about it, where they were trying to say that Julia Roberts, some Hollywood executive floated the idea of Julia Roberts playing that role. I was like, okay. I'm like, y'all know y'all fucked up with Gods of Egypt, because anybody knows who's a historian that Gods of Egypt, that basically Egypt is where? In Africa. Africans are what? Black. And y'all made the cast all white. Okay. So I'm like, no, y'all not going to get this wrong.
Well, again, it goes back to whoever controls the media, how people are portrayed. So with Perry getting 330 acres with his Tyler Perry Studios, that's a good look. That's a brilliant thing. But with all of these black actors and actresses and movie stars and writers, how come it took this long just to come up with a film studio?
And the thing is, there was, Oscar Michaud and Tim Reed did it before he did in terms of having their own studios.
And don't forget about Robert Townsend.
Yes, sir. Yes, Robert Townsend. Yes,
Robert
sir.
Townsend with partners, Robert Townsend gave birth to the Wayans. He gave birth to a lot of these people that went on to become significant in this era, If there were no Robert Townsend, there would have been no Wayans family. If there were no Wayans family, there would have never been Jim Carrey.
No Tommy Davidson. No Jamie Foxx.
I mean, the list just goes on and on. So we have to learn to give each other our props and commend each other and highlight our own excellence, because if we depend on those, the same people that wouldn't treat us right are not going to be the people to teach us right. So
that's real.
That's why something that y'all doing right now with this Off the Cuff Radio, man, I'm honored to be on y'all's show, and I just hope that we impacted and affected people in a way that inspires them to go look at a book like The Wealth Choice by Dennis Kimbrough, or to go get the book The Big Payback by David Charnas, I believe, where he gives the whole business side of hip-hop's history, or the book The Feminization of the Black Male by Dr. Wesley Muhammad, and that you get inspired to go do your research so your mind will be open to new possibilities and things that you could do. Because newsflash, in case people didn't know, our young people are dying at record paces, and they don't care about nothing. So they're sentencing the new generation to death itself if there's not a change in the trajectory of how we're doing things. So if I got one person to listen to this conversation and chopping it up with y'all as the kings and gods that y'all are, man, I'm grateful, and I feel like I'm going out of 219 in the right way.
Man, look, we appreciate you so much for being on, because that's you know, I know blog talk can kind of be tricky about it, but we definitely, but that's another conversation, because we want to have you back on. We definitely want to talk to you about what's going on.
Maybe
you know,
I can be a special reoccurring guest or something.
Oh, yes, you can.
Most
You're
definitely.
Welcome back anytime.
Maybe
we definitely want to talk.
You know, let me intern or something.
We'll learn as much from you as you learn from us. But yeah,
hey,
but
man,
we definitely
just,
want
look,
to
just send me a message and whenever it's gonna be rebroadcast or uploaded so I can check it out.
Yes,
no
sir,
doubt,
we'll
man.
Do. We'll do.
I'm gonna definitely keep you updated throughout the week on whatever we have clips up there or the entire show in its entirety. I'm gonna definitely see the replays and all that stuff.
Okay, no doubt. And I appreciate
so, yeah,
y'all. Thank y'all for having me.
Great show, man. Very informative. And we definitely appreciate you taking the time out, because I know you're a busy man, to be able to chop it up with us for this 2 hours and a half. Even though we went through we overtime, it was all good because it was all informative. I mean, we need to mix the food with the medicine.
Yes,
come on,
we
man.
Do.
I want to give a shout out to my queen, Humble Bee, and my entire family, and all the people that are fans and supporters, and anybody that has subscribed to the channel. And if you haven't subscribed, make sure you get on there and check me out and support us, because we doing it the independent way. And I like to give a shout out to another good brother of mine that's done a magnificent job with the independent game, and he goes by the name of JT, the Bigger Figure, a.k.a. Fig Panamera.
Shout
man
out
is
to
doing
the Bay
awesome
Area
work.
With JT. Yeah.
Come on, man. Bay Area, stand up, man.
Man, 707
Gary, Indiana, where y'all at?
415-510.
Yeah, let's build, y'all. That we bridging the gap out here.
Let's get it. Sugar T, what's good?
Pomona, yeah, man. Yeah, look. Yeah, ooh. Sugar, sister of E-40. Ooh, Sugar. Whew, I remember when I saw her in the Sprinkle Me video way back in 1995, and I fell in love.
Hey, maybe I can call her and see if she'll be a guest on the show.
We would love to have her. We would love to have her on.
We definitely love to have her on.
Okay, if y'all
on,
get
man.
A chance to send me, if you get a chance to send me a fact sheet or, you know, whatever you want me to know a little more in depth of how long y'all been running the program, when y'all started, how it came about, the whole nine, so I can better represent y'all on my end as an intern of the podcast that y'all doing.
Cool.
Definitely.
Yeah, I'm going to definitely hit you with that this week.
Okay, sounds good.
appreciate you so much,
Khan. We got to sign up out of here because we don't want to get thrown off the air. You know, we running that blog talk time. I mean, they owe it to us anyway, considering that Sandman couldn't get on Friday. So I'm running that bill
on
y'all.
Come on with it.
Hey, if they got any questions, they can call me directly at 219-200-9949, and I answer my phone. Believe that.
Hey, you believe it? On that
blog
note,
talk,
we out of here.
Y'all
want to
have a conversation with him? Y'all want to have a conversation with a blog talk? He just dropped the math. So
on that note, we up out of here. We'll see y'all again this coming Friday night or this coming Sunday night. We running full speed ahead. Be sure to check out us on Instagram at Guillotine2018, YouTube at Off the Cuff Radio. Subscribe and hit that like button. Holler back at us.
Yeah, we out.
We out.